I'm an old reporter.
Thank you very much for having us back.
Well.
It's been a terrible time for us.
That's a pleasure.
A great honor for us to be here. One of the things I wanted to ask you was, I think that most Americans thought the job of being president was impossible. You took office, and I think things have changed, and they feel that you thrive on it. And I sort of wanted to ask you how you discipline yourself and how you plan your activities so it won't overwhelm you.
Well, maybe the 8 years as governor gave me some advanced training for this, because I do remember that when I first became governor, there was a period that I went through in which I thought the world had fallen on my head. And I guess I learned there.
But isn't this more difficult? I mean, isn't there more people and more paper and more...
Yes, and yet I have to say that I think that the presidency, the nearest thing to it in the country is a governorship. You don't have a foreign policy, which does add some problems, but it is the same thing. And it used to be, if you look back at earlier days in which our presidents were mainly found among the governors, and I think that is a better training place than
you'd still recommend
serving in the legislature or something. Yes, but the other thing, I've never felt better in my life physically.
You certainly look it, Mr. President.
I have a little gym upstairs that I get to every afternoon before the day is over.
Tell me, would you recommend the job to a friend?
Yes, he might not be a friend afterward, but, no, I have to say that for someone who really wants to do some things that he believes strongly, and this is the most fulfilling experience I've ever had in my life.
Mr. President, we were curious. Many times in the last 6 weeks, you've been awakened from deep sleep with world crises. How do you get the news? Who brings it to you? Do you have to have coffee? Do you stay up all night? Does Mrs. Reagan get up with you?
No, I try to slip out without her, although it's usually the phone.
Is it a special phone?
In the one at usually just the bedside phone that then, well, when we were, when it has happened, it happened at Atlanta, Georgia when we were on that weekend there. Well, there were two such calls and two such issues, and one of them was the phone, and simply it was Bud McFarland asking, could I come out in the living room and meet the Secretary of State there? So whispered that I was just going out in the living room for a little bit, hoping that she'd go back to sleep, and then I rolled and went out there. Then the second incident down there, one of the stewards, he just slipped in, tiptoed in and touched me on the shoulder and whispered to me, and I slid out and did the same thing again. But then, no, you stay there and do what has to be done.
Well, are you alert immediately? Do you need coffee or anything?
No, I wake up easy. and then more recently at Camp David, it was phone calls.
Do you get to
not in the middle of the night in this case. I wasn't up yet, but it was...
Do you get to dislike having the phone ring because you think there's a problem on your
end? Yes, I can't say that I pick it up with dread, because many times it's just a correction or some information on something or other, but has to be faced.
It's usually a problem. Often
usually, yes.
I wanted to ask you, do you think the American people are behind the committing of troops for a military action? And do you think, this is a more serious question, do you think that the number of casualties influences how they feel about something?
Oh, it has to. This has to be the hardest thing in all of this job, and certainly in my life, and that is committing these splendid young men and women to tasks where you know there is that threat. I've never been so proud of anything as I am of the people in our armed forces. A few years ago, there was an entirely different situation, but everyone said the volunteer and military wouldn't work. Well, it is working, and there is an esprit de corps, there's a pride out there among them that just puts a lump in my throat, and then to even one, but then to have a horrible accident or incident such as the one in Lebanon, there just is no way to make that easy. But the thing is to try and, well, first of all, I think many people jumped in advance, not people, such thinking the grassroots, but press and political figures that on the Grenada rescue mission that immediately jumped to the conclusion that this was some kind of a warlike thing that everyone would be angry at, and it was kind of interesting to see so many of them have to try to call back in off the end of the limb when they found out that the American people understood very well what we were doing and supported it. Now, it's harder for them to understand Lebanon, because in Lebanon, they were not sent there to fight, and hopefully there would be no combat. We knew there was a risk because of the kind of violence that had been taking place in the streets over there for a long time. But the whole idea of the multinational force was in connection with our own peace proposal for the Middle East. Lebanon was stalling that. If you remember, you had Israel and Syria both in. Israel had crossed the border because PLO terrorist units were attacking villages across their northern border from Lebanon. The Lebanon government, as of several years ago, was virtually powerless in the face of what can only be termed warlords in their own country of several factions, each with its own militia, fighting each other and fighting the government. And you couldn't proceed with the peace mission until we resolved this problem. So we sent a force in. The idea that, well, first of all, that they'd gotten some 10,000 PLO out. Now the idea was that both Israel and Syria get out. Then a stabilizing force there, while the Lebanese government reformed and created a military force in which it could then take over jurisdiction of its own territory. Well, the first blow was that the Syrians, after saying yes, they would get out, said no, they wouldn't. The Israelis were prepared to get out. Both sides wanted, or the idea was that they would go out simultaneously. And so our force there is there for that purpose. And there wouldn't have been a shot fired by a Marine or by our Navy or Air Force if they had not been shot at. And when that happened, I said, wherever we send them, they're going to have the right to defend themselves and to fire back.
Mr. President, I'm curious, your political godfather or grandfather, if you will, Barry Goldwater, Senator Goldwater, is even calling for the boys to come back from Beirut. And I'm wondering, how far are you willing to commit troops, or how far are you willing to escalate?
It isn't a case of whether we will escalate. That is up to the Syrians and to some of those rebel groups that are fighting the Lebanese military. But we have only fired back when we have been attacked. And I am hopeful that after this last exchange that the Syrians will decide that they don't want to go on that path.
But Mr. President, if they remain recalcitrant, if they remain the Israelis have been bombing them and strafing them and haven't really budged them, if they remain the same and they remain shooting at our reconnaissance flights and downing our flyers, what is the next step?
Well, we're taking the next step right now. Donald Rumsfeld is on his way back there, and we still are going to try for a political solution. We're going to try to negotiate with the Syrians and make them understand.
But if they don't want to negotiate, if they find it in their best interest to be become a thorn in your side, what do you do then?
Well, that becomes a kind of a hypothetical question in which I almost have to wait and see what the circumstances are. Actually, the Lebanese military, which we have helped train and have equipped, and which is a very good military force, is supposed to be resolving the situation for themselves as we try to maintain a little stability in Beirut while they can go forward and do this.
Do you see a day, either in your own, in your next term, for instance, or in the very near future, where President Assad could be, as sort of the present-day dominant force in the Arab world, where he could be could become something like what Anwar Sadat became to us? I mean, do you ever see that kind of relationship ever being able to develop?
I don't see any reason why not. We've made great progress with the other Arab states, the more moderate states. I think that they are very ready for a negotiated settlement, continuing on with the Camp David Accords and the UN resolutions. Syria is the big kid and the bad kid on the block. And the other Arab states have been trying themselves to persuade Syria to join in this effort and to withdraw. And now a new element has been introduced by Syria. They hadn't mentioned this before, but earlier they said, oh yes, they would get out too. They now are not pretending that there is any assault on them or that they're in any danger and that's why they're staying there. They are now claiming that Lebanon properly is a part of a greater Syria. This is outright armed aggression now on their part, hoping to expand their territory at the expense of Lebanon. And they've even indicated at the expense of Jordan.
Mr. President, moving off of that People magazine question, how did you assess the film The Day After? And do you think movies have a way of forming a political opinion?
Well, any motion picture or any drama or play is based on one thing. It isn't successful unless it has or evokes an emotional response. If the audience does not have an emotional experience, whether it's one of hating something or crying or having a lot of laughter, then you've got a failure out there. Well, certainly there was an emotional response to this type of horror film. But apparently it has not had a lasting impact. I haven't seen very much reference to it anymore. And it maybe one of the reasons was because it was a horror film showing you what I'm sure all of us all knew, that a nuclear war is unthinkable. It is sheer horror. It must not happen. But it left you with no idea or solution, no suggestion as to what to do about it. And I think that my own reaction to it was, look, if anything, if this can add to what we've been saying about the fact that there must not be a nuclear war, then maybe the people will understand why we're trying so desperately to get a reduction in those weapons worldwide. And I hope that if we start down the reduction road, that the other side will see the common sense in eliminating them totally. Not since 1946 has there been such a suggestion, and that was made by this country, and even then, when we were the only ones really with a stock of such weapons, the Soviet Union refused.
Let me ask you this question. If Yuri Andropov had been in the room with you watching the film that night, would you have said that very same thing to him?
Yes.
And anything else?
Yes, I would have told him that the only way there could be a war is if they started. We're not going to start a war.
Let me ask you this. Do you have any second thoughts about calling the Soviet Union an evil empire? I think you called the Soviet Union once. Do you have second thoughts about that? Do you wish you hadn't done it?
No. I think that it was high time that we got some realism and got people thinking that for too long we have kind of viewed them as just a mirror image of ourselves, and that maybe we could appeal to their good nature. And we've gone through the experience in a number of years past of saying, well, if we cancel weapon systems, if we unilaterally disarm, maybe they'll see that we're nice people too and they'll disarm. Well, they didn't. They just kept on increasing.
So you see them as a source of evil?
As far, yes, because you have to look at the impact of what we were just talking about, of Lebanon. There they are, with thousands of military advisors and technicians and so forth in Syria, have provided Syria with weapons that are not purely defense weapons, ground-to-ground missiles that can cover virtually every target from Syria in Israel. And they are the ones that seem, whether it's out of paranoia on their part and believing that everyone is an enemy and so they have to be aggressive, or whether it is the Marxist, Leninist theory, more than a theory, commitment that was handed to them, and that was that they must support uprisings wherever they take place in the world to bring about a one-world communist state. Now, no Russian leader has ever refuted that. As a matter of fact, he hasn't had time yet, but every Russian leader up to Andropov at some time or other has publicly restated his commitment to world conquest, world communism.
Let me ask you a question out of that. In the Jerusalem Post, you were quoted, and I don't know if the quote was accurate, as saying that this generation might see Armageddon, that a lot of the biblical prophecies are sort of being played out today, or could be seen
where,
as being
where
played
was that quoted?
In the Jerusalem Post. And I was going to say, is this really true?
I have
do you believe that?
I've never done that publicly. I've talked here among our own people, because there's some theologians quite some time ago were telling me, calling attention to the fact that theologians have been studying the ancient prophecies of what would portend the coming of Armageddon,
mm-hmm.
and have said that never in the time between the prophecies and now up until now has there ever been a time in which so many of the prophecies are coming together. There have been times in the past when people thought the end of the world was coming and so forth, but never anything like this. And one of them, the first one who ever broached this to me, and I won't use his name, I don't have permission to, or he probably would give it, but I'm not going to ask, had held a meeting with the then head of the German government years ago when the war was over, and did not know that his hobby was theology. And he asked this theologian, what did he think was the next great news event worldwide? And the theologian very wisely said, well, I think that you're asking that question indicates that you have a thought along that line. And he did. It was about the prophecies and so forth. So no, I've talked conversationally about that.
You've mused on it. You've considered it.
Not to the extent of throwing up my hands and saying, well, it's all over. No. I think whichever generation at whatever time that time comes, the generation that is there, I think will have to go on doing what they believe is right.
Even if it counts.
Yes.
To ask you a serious question which comes out of this, I see around since my last visit here many more signs that the government is worried about terrorism. It's a time of that. Do you yourself think about dying, think about the fear of the position you're in?
Well, you can't help but be conscious because the security measures are also evident to you. But if you mean, do I go around fearfully looking over my shoulder? No, I have confidence in the security people. I had the one taste of a
hook. Yes, and a touch of another.
And I never second-guess the security people when they tell me we're going to do something or change some way of doing things, and we're doing it, I accept
that.
Is
it something you talk about, for instance, to Mrs. Reagan or your children? Is it something you just, it's better left unsaid?
Yes, very much so, because I think it was harder for them when it did happen than it was for me. Mm-hmm. And much more difficult for her, especially to get over. It's a lot easier to worry about someone else than it is to worry about yourself. Mm-hmm. And so I know what must go through her mind when I set out on some expedition or some public appearance or something. Mm-hmm. And I wish it didn't have to be.
Does your bulletproof shirt or jacket or coat or whatever hanging in the family quarters, or do they keep it someplace else?
No, they keep it, and when they come, having in hand, and they kind of come in flinching because they know that I.
What do you say?
I do not accept it with good grace.
What do you say though when they put it on you?
Oh, even an occasional unprintable word. But I also know that they would not be bringing it in unless they felt there was a reason for it. But it isn't pleasant. It's uncomfortable. That's the main thing.
Is it bulky or is it heavy or what?
Well, it's bulky, and I work so hard in that gym up there, and then they say everybody out there in the audience will think I'm getting fat.
Mr. President, away from Armageddon and all this talk of dying, and back to 1984, did you cringe when you had to sign the order to have your own aides take lie detector tests? And I'm curious, have you ever taken one, and how did you feel?
No, I never have, but I didn't sign an order for them to take it. This has been misconstrued, and I bless you for giving me a chance to explain it. We had a meeting that came on national security. Rules and regulations, the security of the information there. And there was a leak. And it was a leak which could cost some Americans their lives. And this is a criminal act when there's a violation of national mm-hmm. security. And I called the Justice Department on this. I thought it was serious enough, and I said I wanted an investigation of how this happened, guard against the future. Mm-hmm. Now, such an investigation, without my designating it as such, if it is a violation of national security, it's a criminal investigation. Mm-hmm. If it is a criminal investigation, the FBI has the right to ask for a lie detector test. But being a criminal investigation, the individual has the right to refuse them. And that's all. But that's been distorted that I suddenly...
Well, have you ever taken one?
No.
No. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Did your aides finally do...
I don't know. I don't even know whether the FBI even asked for them or not. They determine that, and that is within the law. And then if somebody says no, they report that also in their investigating report, but, mm-hmm. That they asked and it was refused. But I don't know whether any have been given or any have been asked.
Mr. President, I hate to interrupt, but we've got time for about one more. You've got Governor DeMagin waiting for you.
Oh, goodness.
Mr. President, who do you think the easiest Democrat would be to beat in 1984?
If I answered that question, I might be helping them to choose out of that octet they've got out there. And I'm not going to help them in their choice.
There's not one you're relishing running against?
Oh, there may be, but I haven't said yet that I'm running.
I have two questions that I would not till Christmas.
I'd like to ask, there's two questions. One, I was thinking in this year of living dangerously, and I wondered how in the world do you maintain the very obvious romance you have with Mrs. Reagan? I mean, romance takes time, and it takes mood, and it takes not being harried. And what sort of special things do you do to maintain this togetherness?
in these tough times?
Well, I don't know. We've always been very close, and they've developed up as there would in 30 odd years. Little things that are kind of traditional or that have a meaning to us from times back. And
can you cite any of them that, I mean, I think especially in your article in Parade, you showed how much you loved her and how much the romance continues and whatever. I just wondered if there's sort of small things you do to keep this touching this together.
Well, there are certain occasions when we leave notes for each other and things of that kind mm-hmm. that we still do.
Is there a special place you leave them? Or?
Oh no, it just depends on things like on a breakfast tray and on certain occasions and in cars mm-hmm. that always remember.
Mr. President, we really, I'm sorry, okay. We have to break this up.
Could I ask one more question for my mother, who you gave a story to last year, and we kept hearing from our readers about the peg-legged pig. You remember the story you told me about the pig with the wooden leg?
Oh.
We thought that this has become a tradition for the magazine, and we wondered, do you have a good story to tell the readers, and indeed my mother, who is now 84, this year, a very good story.
That because I've done that story. Yes, I have one that I've told in a couple of speeches lately that I kind of enjoy. And that is a young fellow in a small town, and he would make a very good living selling fish to the local restaurant. But the fish and game people got a little curious to where he was coming up with all these fish. And his uncle happened to be the sheriff. So he said, why don't you ask your nephew if you can go fishing with him someday? And I'd like to know where he's getting these fish. So the uncle did, and they were out in the middle of the lake, and the uncle started to put his line in the water, and the nephew reached in the tackle box, pulled out a stick of dynamite, lit it, threw it in, the explosion, belly up, came all the fish, and he started pulling them in. And his uncle said, Nephew Elmer, he says, do you realize you've just created a felony? Elmer reached in the tackle box and came up with another stick of dynamite, lit the fuse, handed it to the sheriff, and says, did you come out here to fish or to talk?
Very good, Mr. President.
Mr. President, thank you very, very much once again. I hope you and Chris have a Merry Christmas.
Well, thank you. The same to you.
We certainly appreciate it. Thank you.
Have a good evening.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.